everybody. Thanks for joining me here today. As we move forward with our phased-in approach to reopen Manitoba for business, our priority has been and continues to be the safety and health of all Manitobans. And at the same time, we've been striving, as I know every jurisdiction has, to find the balance, carefully reopening our businesses so that Manitobans can access the services they need, and also helping others to return to work and be able to collect a paycheck. So when the pandemic hit Manitoba, it was tough on all of us, and it continues to be. Record numbers of Manitobans have been out of work, but carefully we've been finding ways to help people get back to work. And the latest labor force survey shows Manitoba led the country in student employment in June, and we hope to continue to do that. We know this has been a particularly stressful time for our students. I had the chance to reconnect with my nephew who just graduated from high school. I know for many of our high school graduates, this is a, we'll say a strange year, to put it mildly. But I know also that our young people are looking forward to having the work experience that many Manitobans have enjoyed as younger people, and they hope to get back to a situation where they can get employment and support themselves as they pursue their goals in life, whether it be post-secondary education or moving on in the working world. We've created more than 8,600 jobs for students here in Manitoba through several specific targeted programs. That is quadruple, we are told, the previous provincial record in any year, and speaks to our commitment to focus our efforts on helping young people in Manitoba to find employment. And I want to say thank you to those in the small business community and in the charitable and nonprofit sectors who have assisted in making sure that young people had the chance to find some meaningful work over the summer. And as you know, this summer employment program was extended recently to include any ages and to go into October, to the end of October. And so in reference specifically to young people, I know that, like myself, many young people might need to, as I did in years gone by, have some employment during the upcoming school year. This program will not exclude young people. Our new employment program has been expanded and deepened, and it will allow young people to continue to receive employment going into the fall as well. We also created a team of eight business students to reach out to businesses, to encourage them directly to hire students. And who better than students to directly promote the value of hiring a student? So far they've made more than 7,000 contacts with employers, and that has contributed to an almost 100% increase in hires during the time that they have been active, and a 44% increase in job postings as well. So again, we appreciate everyone who's been out there working. We think of those, of course, who are tens of thousands of Manitobans who have yet, as of yet, not been able to return to work. We know that for all of you, it hasn't been easy. A while back, we announced approximately four weeks ago, a risk recognition program to thank Manitobans in the front line, public-facing roles who have been exposed to increased risks during on the job during the pandemic. We want to say that we appreciate your work, and we thank you for it. And we also want to say thank you to all those who put in their applications to receive a share of this program. Il y a quelque temps, nous avons annoncé un programme de reconnaissance des risques pour remercier les Manitobains en première ligne face au public qui était exposé à des risques accrus au travail pendant la pandémie. Nous vous remercions de votre patience pendant que nous examinions chaque demande que nous avons reçue. Because we had planned initially to split the money evenly, equally, between all eligible applicants, we needed to make sure of the eligibility to get an exact count. And so finance officials, and I thank them, in the finance department have been working through all the applications for the last few weeks. I'm pleased today to announce that we are dividing the $120 million that's been allocated in a partnership between the federal and provincial governments, equally among 78,442 applicants. And this week, they will be notified by email, and they will get a direct deposit into their bank account. Aujourd'hui, je suis heureux d'annoncer que nous divisions 120 millions de dollars également entre 78,442 Manitobans. You'll excuse my lack of French. Cette semaine, ils seront informés par courriel et recevront un virement automatique sur le compte bancaire. So the deposits will amount to $1,377. And if you do the math, you would note that that takes into account a 10% withhold of tax, since the payment is taxable income under federal rules. Payments will be going to more than 44,000 workers in retail and lodging, 27,000 workers in healthcare, and approximately 9,000 workers in social services as well. And again, we say thank you to all those workers. We sincerely hope that this is money that you can use for your purposes, and we hope that you consider that with this extra money, you might be able to spend some to support a local business or to support the local economy and to help someone else who may not have had the chance to get back to work yet, the chance to get employed. We can't thank you enough for the role you play in supporting Manitobans through this difficult time, and this this indication, this payment is an indication of that appreciation. I know it hasn't been easy for most Manitobans through this process, but we are in this together, and we are supportive people of one another, and that has been shown in countless ways over these last number of weeks and months. I would also reference, if you are struggling emotionally or in terms of your mental health through this time, and you would need some extra help with your anxiety because of the pandemic, reminder that the Virtual Ability CBT program is available to you. So far, more than 2,700 Manitobans have signed up for this online therapy program. And we've still seen a steady interest in this program. Approximately 50 people per week have continued to sign up for the service. So I say to those of you who may be struggling that you aren't alone. We are with you. We'll help you to get through this. Thank you. Take your questions.
There were more than 90,000 people that had originally applied for the risk recognition pay. What were some of the kind of top reasons why this dropped to about 78,000?
There were some applications from non-public facing, principally, not exclusively manufacturing, that type of area. I would say that might be the principal block of folks that didn't qualify. And I'd mention, and I should say thank you too, to our labor representatives. We had a committee of, I believe, 14 different groups of whether unionized, non-unionized, private sectors, public sector, that gave us advice on how to structure our programs, and appreciated their advice and help with this. We weren't unanimous, that would be highly unlikely, but there was a pretty strong consensus that we needed to have the program address the needs of supporting those with lower incomes and supporting those who had more public-facing responsibilities. We're dealing, interfacing with the public on a regular basis, so that was the rationale for that.
There was some frustration, I guess might be the best word for people, that it was taking so long to do the due diligence and do all of that. Maybe can you speak to that a little bit about why it took so long and maybe why that was important as well?
Well, it's important to get it right, and important to make sure you're not sending out checks and asking for them back, you know, and to make sure that because we're dividing it among the eligible recipients, that we had a pretty accurate number. I would argue, you know, 4 weeks is not a long time to roll out a program of this complexity. Remember, too, that we expanded it to get more applications in, and we actually tripled the amount of applications roughly between the middle of June and right at the end of June. So the checking the finance officials had to do was pretty significant in a fairly short period of time. So I'm not going to be apologetic about this. I think it's a good news thing for our frontline workers today. And I'll just simply say I really thank the people who work in our civil service for the speed with which they dealt with this close to 100,000 applications and making sure that they got it right.
I know part of the concern with not wanting to roll this out too soon was the fact that there might be some double applications from people. Was that a factor? Did you find many double applications once you were going through this list?
I didn't. It's a good question. I didn't get a breakdown to that degree. I only know there were approximately 10% that were ineligible, and there were various reasons. I think, as I said earlier, I think the biggest one might have been some of the employers took it upon themselves to apply, you know, some hundreds of their workers for the program who were outside of the parameters, but it had to be determined pretty much on an individual basis who was eligible and who was not. So a lot of work went into this.
Could there be an appeal process?
Well, we hope not. We hope it's not necessary. Obviously, when you're dealing with 100,000, there's a chance, there's an error rate, and you hope it's as low as possible. That was our goal with this, was to, in the 4 weeks we had, to make sure that we got it as close as we could to accurate.
Premier, yesterday, eighth COVID death in the province, and we got almost no information about this case, and not even whether the man had underlying health conditions. And I'm wondering what your views are in terms of giving good information. We're heading into an era where we want to open up the economy some more, but people need to make decisions, and they need to make them on these decisions on good information. And if we don't have good information on the people who are getting seriously ill and die, it seems to go against that. I'm just wondering what's your feeling. Should we, given privacy concerns, should the public have more information about some of these cases?
First of all, I'm not sure how aware in advance of this, and first of all, my condolences to those who lost a loved one here, obviously, and a friend. But I'm not sure, and I haven't had a chance yet to be briefed by Dr. Rusin on this, how much information our public health officials actually had on this specific case. And obviously, as Dr. Rusin would advise me, and I'm sure has said here numerous times, he won't want to talk about individual cases. That being said, in general, of course, I'm in agreement with making sure the public is aware of these situations as much as we possibly can. I would side with those who say it's better to have the information than to keep it from the public, yes.
Because we've found that this has been an issue all along in terms of trying to get more information, and especially on cases where people are either severely ill or, you know, what.
It's difficult, isn't it, Larry? Yeah. Because, I mean, we just went through a situation where there was some question raised about the consequences of referencing how to write colony in respect to a case, you know, and you're obviously familiar with this. And I want to say to Manitobans, and this is very important and pertinent to information being made available. We have thousands of people in Hutterian communities across the province who are doing their very, very best in the face of a difficult challenge for them. And people who react just because they see a Hutterite person as a consequence of knowing that there have been a number of cases on Hutterite colonies, should be reminded that these are folks who have been there for us on many, many occasions. I'm familiar with numerous cases where people from Hutterian communities have come forward and helped after a tornado in one of our, my former federal constituency. They came and they rogued the field. They took every piece of metal, every piece of debris out of a neighbor's field. They've been there with food and support to help other people. Don't stigmatize people on the basis of anything. Treat people with respect, patience, and kindness. Remember that this is something we're all in together. It's not going to be a short-term thing. It's going to be a long-term thing. And I know that Dr. Rusin has done his best, and I thank him for that. And I know that we want to make sure the information is out there as best we can while always respecting the privacy obligations we have. That's a balance, and it's a difficult one.
Speaking of reopening, if Winnipeg does become the CFL hub city, is the province going to guarantee a loan for the league or club? Is there any financial assistance on offer? Because we're told that the financial assistance may come through the Business Development Bank of Canada, and that would likely require loan guarantees of some sort from the provinces involved.
We made a decision to offer on this hub city bid on the basis of, I think, good preliminary analysis at the very least that shows that there's profitability there for the people of Manitoba. The Manitoba taxpayer is not being asked to subsidize the Bombers. They're not being asked to subsidize the CFL. What they are going to do is help people get back to work in the hospitality industry, get back to work in the food industry, and the taxes derived from that will approximately double the commitment we're making towards assisting in a restart. the other discussions around the CFL that have taken place and will continue to as soon as 2 o'clock this afternoon are not exclusively around the hub city issue or the CFL. These are discussions among the premiers and potentially with the prime minister around how we continue to restart our economy nationally. I have little to add to this issue today. When I have more to add, I will add it.
So you haven't received a request for a loan guarantee for the CFL?
When I have more to add, I'll certainly add it.
Mr. Premier, you said, and Dr. Russo said the same thing as well, as to you caution people to look at the rising case numbers, but instead look at other factors such as the positivity rate, which we've also obviously seen go up. We're seeing it go up to us in the West as well as more cases happen there. What are your thoughts on the extended travel ban back to the West here, as we heard Minister Friesen speak to a little bit as well?
Well, You're quite right, Brittany. You know, you refer to case numbers, and we have gotten in the habit of doing that. Case numbers are not illustrative as effectively as positivity numbers. So in terms of what we're facing right now, Manitoba's positivity numbers have actually dropped in the last week, and that's good news. Other jurisdictions have seen rising and falling numbers. Ontario's recently seen a nice decrease, and we hope it continues. I think the most important thing to remember isn't anything other than that all of us, not just in Manitoba, but elsewhere, need to understand that social distancing is the key here. And that's not to discount any of the other factors. Masks can have an impact, and that'll be a subject of debate, I expect, increasingly in the next number of weeks and months. But social distancing, that's the key. And so we must maintain our social distancing practices, because that's been fundamental to the success Manitobans have seen in our ability to protect our people and to recover, and that's fundamental to other things. And this is not to discount other issues like the travel issues, but you know, no amount of travel is safe if people come here and don't practice social distancing. And a much greater amount of travel will have to happen before we can recharge our economy and help tens of thousands of Manitobans and millions of Canadians get back to work, because our economies are intertwined with one another. And as we move forward, the United States is not doing well, to put it mildly, and that's our largest trading partner. And so a slowing of our economy as a consequence of the United States' challenges is most likely. This makes it all the more important that we get rid of the barriers between our Canadian provinces in terms of trade, so that we can increase our ability to support each other in the Canadian family. And that is what I'll continue to advocate for, and what thankfully the premiers of the country are advocating for as well. And this is a rare time, I think, obviously with this pandemic, but it's a time to seize the opportunity to get rid of these archaic barriers between our provinces. That doesn't mean to say that we shouldn't have concern about interprovincial travel. We must, but that means that we have to be understanding that if we try to restrict interprovincial travel, we're restricting the ability of Canadians to get back to work.
Social distancing being key, one of the areas that people have talked about there being a lack of potential social distancing is when it comes to going back to school. Mm. Do you have any update on when we're going to be seeing that plan? I know originally it was August 1st, that's a Saturday of a long weekend. Are we going to be getting it prior to that?
Prior to the end of the week, you'll get detailed information from our education minister. I know he's been working very hard with his partners throughout the educational community, if I could say that, you know, the school boards, the school division, senior executives, the MTS and others, to come up with a game plan that we can communicate. And I think it's very important. I just had the chance to be part of a number of community consultations in the last couple of days where people were expressing a variety of interests and concerns that they had. And one of those was obviously how much advance notice can you give us about how we're going to get our kids to school? And this was very important. You know, will the buses be running? A number of other questions, but I'll let the education minister address those in the not-too-distant future.
Your name came up in the House of Commons committee testimony yesterday, as one of the Kielbergers said you were a great supporter of We Day. I know you spoke at one. I assume you were paid. You were there as premier, so can you confirm that you were not
every penny I received.
you were not paid for that the speech, correct? And the government...
Never accepted a, as a politician, I've never accepted a fee for speaking.
And in 2016, the government gave money to something called We Act, which was connected to We Day. It was about $250,000.
Right. In addition, we have had an agreement in the past, approximately $150,000 for We in the Classroom activities to support various undertakings to initiate community volunteerism, to support, to encourage young people to understand their citizenship, a variety of parts of that program. We're re-examining that in the context of what we've learned so far. What is in question about the WE organization and some of its operations. But this isn't the principal issue I think Canadians care about. I think the larger issue would be the ethical concerns about the giving of an untendered contract to an organization, obviously, that has given significant financial support to not just the Prime Minister's family, but also the Finance Minister and his family as well. So that's the issue I think that needs to be investigated further. One of the problems with the committee structure that was put on display yesterday, if I could be blunt, and I've been part of it and I understand it, is that half those questions were softball questions and that you weren't able to, these weren't journalistically designed questions to get to the bottom of an issue, right? They were pablum. And so I think there are more questions than there were answers yesterday. And I don't say that as a criticism of the Kilberger brothers. It's not meant that way.
When you say you're re-examining, does the provincial money flow directly to the schools or does it go through the WE organization? And what exactly are you re-examining?
Well, it's been a contract, I believe, sort of done on an annual basis. We budgeted an amount. There's no contract. We're not breaking any contract with WE, but there was a budgeted amount allocated for about $150,000 to do for WE in the Classroom programs to be run. It's a partnership program, and I just invite you to ask the Education Minister more about it. If you like more detail, he'd be better equipped than me to give you the detail.
So the money went through WE, not directly from the government to the classroom.
I have to verify that. I'm not sure about the structure of how it went. If it went to school divisions first and then to WE, either way, WE got it at the end, yeah, in the past.
And why are you re-examining it?
Re-examining because there's some ethical questions that have been raised about WE in the nature of its connections to its profit versus its nonprofit organization that have to be addressed. Money going from one to the other, and how that's been handled. You've seen Globe and Mail work by Campbell Clark, for example, in detail looking at that issue. I'd like to see. I think Manitobans want us to deal with companies that are dealing ethically. There's no disputing that the WE charity organization has done some tremendous good work, but that being said, there are some questions that have to be answered about where the money has gone in the WE charity organization and how it's been handled.
For you two members of your communications staff, I'm no longer with you, and I'm just wondering, is this a shakeup or in communications of the government, or is this belt tightening? How would you describe it?
Well, we maintain, as you know, we maintain a much lower budget for communications than the previous administration, we'll put it mildly. That being said, hardest part of running any organization is human resource management, and it isn't easy. And I thank everyone who's worked with us, but there are changes that have to be made sometimes, and they're difficult changes to make, and we've made some.
You find are you looking for a new approach in communications? Because both these people were senior communications people. So do you feel a change in tone or systems is necessary?
I coached for a few years. I know that the hardest part about that to me was making lineups. I'll just leave it there.
Dr. Lucen is suggesting masks that very well could be in the fall, sort of a recommendation, not mandatory, in indoor public spaces. Do you see that as a necessary step in this province?
If you're asking me, do I see Dr. Lucen discussing masks as a necessary part of the process, I would agree. That's an important thing.
Do you think that should be what our province goes forward?
We haven't... made a habit of me venturing in on the medical advice. Dr. Rusin takes the lead on that, and I have questions sometimes for him, and we have good discussion, but we've been doing well as a province by making sure that we keep the politicians away from the major health decisions, and I think that's the way we're going to continue to proceed. I think one of the benefits of the discussions that we've had, and I think the inputs he's received from our health minister and others, are the sharing of perspectives and questions that the public has asked, and I think we've endeavored to do a pretty good job. I hope we have done a pretty good job of involving the public in our discussions around this pandemic so that we can get input and questions can be asked that then Dr. Rusin is prepared to understand and answer. And those sharing of those perspectives is really important. One of them that I think is important to understand is that there can be a danger with masks if people assume that social distancing no longer is relevant. That's a real danger. And people to put it in street language, people get a phony sense of security when they wear a mask, that somehow it's fine to not social distance anymore, and it isn't. So there are some drawbacks, and I think the benefit of the process we've used is that it gives the opportunity for the public to have their part and their input into the discussion, and then we all come out of it a little better informed as a consequence. And I think that your industry has played a major role in helping that to happen, and we've endeavored through our websites and our consultative approaches on our phases thus far to also have that opportunity given to the public to come in with comments, suggestions, questions, these types of things. And we've done this in a reasonably timely way too, so it's not been used as sometimes done with consultations, I think, as a delay mechanism. It's been done to work towards the goal of moving forward if we can, and if people forget about social distancing and staying home when they're sick, it may have to be done to move backward at some point. We hope not. We all hope not. But that's the reality of the situation, is we're going to do as well as we can do only if we follow the fundamentals of protecting ourselves and each other.
On the bonus pay, you had estimated earlier on that there would be around 100,000 Manitobans who could be eligible. We have less than 80,000 that will be receiving this. Was that initial estimate off, or do you imagine that there were around 20,000 people who did not apply?
I remember the two specific things that I asked you to give me latitude on. One was the estimated number of people, the other was the estimated payment. And I stand by the process we used. I think it was a reasonable one, a fair and consultative one, that involved groups, frankly, that represent over 100,000 workers in Manitoba. It was a pretty good process. And I know no process will be perfect, but we were given the opportunity to do something for our frontline people. We handled it, I think, in as reasonable a manner as we could, and in a reasonable time frame, are getting money out to those frontline workers. There's always room for criticism, and I'm quite aware that I'll bear the brunt of that, and that's fine. But I am very proud of our frontline people, and this is a way to show it, and I know Manitobans support that.
Do you believe, though, there are thousands of people that were eligible that did not apply?
I think given the efforts we made, the outreach and the involvement of the organizations helped to make that less likely. I think that having the Retail Council and having the major unions, public sector unions at the table made sure that they did a pretty good job of following up with their members, and their people were given the awareness that they needed to apply. And I would hope that that's the case. But I would also remind Manitobans at this point, as much as we do sincerely support and thank our frontline workers today, that there are tens of thousands of Manitobans who don't have a job right now. And to remember that they're counting on you to help them get back to work. And that means doing the right things on social distancing. And it also means if you have a little extra money and you can afford to support a local small business and help them hire somebody back so people can get a job. It means that too.
Do you have any on your program that had people getting off served back to work here in Manitoba? How many people have taken you up on that offer and gotten back to work?
Yeah, I don't know if I have that with me, but it's steady. It just continues to move up. We're looking forward to the numbers next week, the job numbers. We're hopeful that we're continuing to move in the right direction, but we know there's a lot more work to be done.
Mr. Premier, you've talked about the consultation processes that you guys have done. Did you do a public consultation process for the CFL to become a hub city, or Winnipeg to become a CFL hub city, or do you plan to seek public opinion or consultation on those plans?
No, we didn't have the time to do that. What we must do, though, and have been doing, is to make sure that the safety protocols that we're putting in place are, that they really have the effect of protecting Manitobans, and we make sure that they're adhered to. And we also need to communicate those so Manitobans understand that that is the case, that there are protection measures that are going to be in place to make sure that Manitoba and Manitobans continue to lead the country in protecting our people from COVID.
For those protocols, I take it consulting with business leaders or other groups as well to put those protocols in place?
Dr. Risen will give you more on that, I expect, on Thursday, tomorrow. I understand that we've reviewed the protocols that are used by other major sports leagues to varying degrees of success. Some of them very successful, some of them less so. Obviously, we'll take the best practices we can find and we'll adopt them here.
Thank you, Mr. Premier. We're going to go to the phone now. Up first, from CBC Radio Canada, Ezra.
Hi, Mr. Premier. Ezra Butt from the French CBC. We've learned that several Saskatchewan hockey teams took extraordinary measures to hide their participation in a Winnipeg hockey tournament in July and amid the pandemic. What are your thoughts on that situation and on hosting out-of-province sports teams with a lot of players entering our city?
Well, if the reports are accurate, and I have no verification of that at this point, if they're accurate, obviously I'm very disappointed, and I'm sure that hockey organizers, coaches, volunteers, players all around the country are disappointed in that behavior. Skirting the rules of Saskatchewan, disobeying the conduct rules in our province is not acceptable, and so we're very disappointed in the choices that were made there and wouldn't want to see a repeat of that type of thing.
In the case where you would learn that those information were accurate, if you get a report or anything, could you imagine that there could be consequences for those teams or the parents of those players?
Well, I'll point out, yes, that we'll get the information and follow up. I'll be talking to Premier Moe later today on a number of issues. This may make it onto the agenda. We're not, either of us, very happy when we see people ignoring the rules we've laid out, which are designed to protect others. And they're also, it should be pointed out, designed to protect the participants. The very people who skirted the rules are the ones who put themselves in danger as well. Their parents should understand that and know that, and that behavior shouldn't be repeated.
From CTV Winnipeg, Jeff.
Hi, Mr. Premier. Jeff, CTV Winnipeg. Are high school students going back to class this fall?
Well, yes, but the detail around that is what's going to be shared before the end of the week by the education minister as a result of intensive efforts by a number of people in the education various fields of endeavor in the education world.
Thank you for that. And do you envision staggered dates to be able to accommodate physical distancing and maybe capping classes, or will you be adding spaces?
I don't think I'll preview the education minister's work. I think that it would be appropriate to have Calvin Gertsen speak to the plan that is in the final stages of readiness to be presented to Manitobans, but I know that Manitobans will be relieved, not only parents, but students as well, and every one of us takes a great interest in the education of our children in this province. We know that's the investment in our future that we all want to see made intelligently and safely.
From City News, Stephanie.
Does the province plan to hire any more teachers as a part of that plan? and to promote physical distancing to be able to maybe have those smaller class sizes.
Well, again, I think the education minister will be able to give you more elaborate details, Stephanie, than I can. We've been adding, of course, teachers on a regular basis, and we continue to maintain the social distancing practices that the doctor, Dr. Rusin has recommended and others have reminded us of. So those practices will be incorporated, I'm sure, into the announcement the education minister will be making.
Sorry, no follow-up. Thanks.
Thanks, Stephanie.
From the Brandon Sun, Colin.
Hi, Mr. Premier. Colin Slark from the Brandon Sun here. The last time we spoke, you had indicated that some of your fellow premiers had voiced support for your thoughts about the need for CERB reform. I was just wondering if you'd made any progress with talking to the federal government or your fellow premiers about reforming the program.
Yeah, well, this is on the agenda for further discussions in the not-too-distant future. I can only say that, again, I want to be clear about this. The CERB program had served its purpose early on as a necessary response to the fact that hundreds of thousands of Canadians were thrown out of work. But the problem is now the impact of earning more than $1,000 in a month is that you lose the CERB benefit in totality. So in other words, if you make $1,000, you get to keep $2,000 of CERB benefit for a total of $3,000. You can support yourself, might even be able to support if you're a single parent, might even be able to manage a household with that little money. But if you take one more shift, you lose $2,000. And this puts you in a very difficult situation, and so the benefit should be maintained and not ended in total when someone hits $1,001. It should cascade down. That would make sense. I think most Canadians would support that concept, and the federal government needs to make this adjustment to the CERB program, and should have made this adjustment, frankly, weeks and months ago, because we're getting numerous reports that this is interfering with people's decisions. Quite logically, if you're making $1,000 and you can take one more shift, why would you take the risk of taking one more shift if it's going to cost you $2,000 to do it? And so it gets in the way of people being able to get back to work, and it gets in the way of small businesses being able to hire people, and it's just interfering with the recovery in many parts of the country. So we'll continue to keep asking the federal government to address this issue. It's a design flaw. And I'd reemphasize, it's not about eliminating the CERB. It's about eliminating the penalty or the disincentive that exists within the CERB. That is the important thing that has to be addressed.
A follow-up question. Thank you.
And that's it from the phone, Mr. Premier.
You said just a minute ago, Premier, that Dr. Rusin would be talking to us on Thursday. I thought they were going to once a week.
They could start next week.
Also, he's going to be with us tomorrow then.
Well, you know, I guess we'll have to verify that, Larry. Understanding was they're going to switch to once a week on Thursdays, but let's verify it and get back to you on that.
Are you expecting to hear a final decision on CFL Hub City, the whole continuation of the league this week?
As of this morning, I haven't got information. There's a collective agreement yet. That's going to be a big part of this, obviously.
Yeah.
Do you know if the province has had to issue any more fines for people who were not abiding by social distancing and all of that? I know we talked about this weeks ago, but...
Yeah. No, let's... Larry raised this topic earlier. I don't see any reason why we shouldn't be able to compile those for you at least to... I don't know, daily, but we should be able to do that once a week, because I know there has been ongoing efforts to make sure that there's compliance. And there needs to be. You know, all of us are waiting with bated breath, I think, for fall and winter, and we know that flu season is a sort of a national pastime around winter climates like ours. And we're very concerned that we be ready. There's good and bad with that, as there is with a lot of things in this pandemic. The bad part is that it may make people fearful. And the good part is that it may make people responsible. And it's that balancing act that we're trying to achieve here, not to scare people. Many people are very frightened by this pandemic. I don't want to add to that unnecessarily. But we also have to remember that if we follow the fundamentals, flu season be darned, if we follow the fundamentals, we're going to have a better chance of continuing to help our province recover and help our people get back to work and have jobs and support their families. These are important things. So again, I want to say thank you to Manitobans for doing their part and for following the fundamentals, because in doing it, you're protecting yourself for sure, but you're also protecting other people. But in doing it, you're also helping people get back to work. And there are many, many Manitobans right now, tens of thousands, that would love to be able to support themselves, and they don't want to live on a federal subsidy the rest of their lives. They want to have a chance to go and do something with their lives, offer a service to somebody, use their skills to help people. To do that, they need us all to do our part. So keep doing the right things, be patient with each other and help each other and support each other, and remember that we're all in this together, and together we can beat this thing.